My name is Mark Massa. I'm the Dean of the School of Theology and Ministry here at BC. It's an honor to host these events. We have a real treat tonight. It's sort of a fairly serious, high firepower group of people. And I decided rather than ranking them, we're just going to do it alphabetically, which will make it easier for me and easier for you. What we'll do is I've asked each of our distinguished guests here to do a 2 to 3 minute sort of discussion of where they are on the basic question, which was the title of this evening's event, Pope Francis, the Theology of Pope Francis, Real Reform or Window Dressing. And then after every two, our trusty GAs, our graduate assistants, are gonna go around and they're gonna collect your questions. So if you would, as these questions come up, please write something out, pass them to the end of the row, and the GA will take them. And in the second part of our conversation, we'll be discussing your questions. So let me introduce to you our distinguished guest. To my immediate left is Father Jim Bretzke, a Jesuit who's a professor of moral theology here at the STM, and he is our public voice. How many interviews have you given this year?
This year, only about 50.
50, so I would say he's a man without an unpublished thought. So whenever something happens to the Pope or it happens at the Vatican, they go to Jim, the New York Times, the Washington Post, all kinds of the Boston Globe, they go to Jim to ask. To his left is Susannah Heschel, distinguished professor of Jewish studies at Dartmouth and a co-conspirator of mine on the Harvard Visitation Committee. To her left is Kristin Heyer, a very happy new hire, professor of Christian social ethics in the theology department here at Boston College. To her left is Kathy Kaveny, Professor Kathleen Kaveny, professor of both theology and law here at Boston College. To her left is Father Jim Reese, Tom Reese. Father Tom Reese, a Jesuit who is a senior analyst for the National Catholic Reporter and genuinely smart commentator on all kinds of things. How many hours did you get during the Pope? How many hours of TV time did you have during the Pope?
I've lost count.
Okay, so. Yeah, exactly. So. And to his left is Michael Sean Winters, who is a visiting fellow at the Institute for Policy Research at Catholic University. And as for those of you who are regular and devout readers of the NCR know, a trusty, reliable, and provocative in the best sense writer for the NCR. So thank you all very much. And we're just going to do this alphabetically. So we're going to start with Jim. Jim, you go first. So the Theology of Pope Francis, Window Dressing or Real Reform?
My remarks are entitled, under a thesis statement, two words and two anecdotes. Theology of Pope Francis, Real Reform or Window Dressing. Instead of choosing either or, I'm proposing a both and answer. Window dressing is often connected to real reform, as we saw quite clearly in Pope Francis's initial appearance on the Loggia of St. Peter's with his striking request that all pray for him before he imparted his first Urbi et Orbi apostolic blessing. Now my supporting thesis statement. What we are experiencing in the pontificate of Pope Francis in ways large, small, and in between is what science historian Thomas Kuhn would call a revolutionary paradigm shift. Cultural paradigms do not shift easily or quickly, and very often there is considerable Sturm und Drang in the unfolding process. Now on to two words taken from the Italian original of the recently released apostolic exhortation, The Joy of Love. Meschino, in paragraph number 304, is mistranslated in the Vatican English version as reductive, whatever that might mean. The Italian word would be better rendered as narrow-minded or petty, making the ensuing statement much stronger. It is narrow-minded simply to consider whether or not an individual's actions correspond to a general law or rule, because that is not enough to discern and ensure full fidelity to God in the concrete life of the human being. Language of this sort is refreshingly frank, and I would argue supports my overall thesis of a revolutionary paradigm shift. Anacquare, in paragraph number 311, is rendered accurately as watering down, but it is the reverse polarity of the Pope's usage that is so revolutionary. In Vaticanese, watering down is usually a warning against a slide into moral laxity. But here the Pope states that putting, quote, so many conditions on mercy is the worst way of watering down the gospel, unquote. Such an assertion clearly requires a major paradigm shift in magisterial moral exhortation. Now onto my two brief anecdotes. Resistance on the right to the Franciscan paradigm shift is exemplified in Cardinal Burke's televised interview, which wondered if Pope Francis's first apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, properly belonged to the genre of papal magisterium. However, in a recent statement on Amoris Laetitia, published in the other NCR, that's the National Catholic Register, His Eminence answers his earlier question with a resounding no, adding that the, quote, personal, that is, non-magisterial nature of the document is also evident in the fact that the references cited, with no consistent effort to relate the text in general, or the citations to the magisterium, the fathers of the church, and other proven authors, unquote. From the other end.
I was wondering how long it would be before he got to Cardinal Burke.
My favorite. From the other end of the theological spectrum comes my second anecdote from an academic colleague of mine, not here, facing a media interview on the exhortation without having had time to read the text. In desperation, I was emailed a simple question. Did the Pope explicitly condemn artificial contraception? Francis had not. And I observed that this sort of question about humani vitae, which has so occupied a certain generation in the church, does not seem to be the Pope's own central concern. Thus, paradigm is not shifting to the left any more than it is to the right, but shifting it definitely is. Primarily, it is a theological paradigm shift to the center, that is, to the center of the gospel, which Pope Francis clearly believes must center on God's mercy, forgiveness, compassion, healing, and reconciliation. The church then is being called to shift from moral citadel to field hospital. And probably nearly everyone in the church is going to have to move a bit if this paradigm shift is to succeed. And as the Italians would say, e così sia, thus let it be.
Thank you. Susannah.
Well, thank you. Thank you for including me in this panel. I'm Jewish, and as a Jew, I have to say that I, of course, have Pope envy. I wish. I keep asking, why can't we have a rabbi like Pope Francis? So,
we've been waiting for a long time for Pope envy, too. So that's okay.
When I look at Pope Francis, I love him. I love him for the kind of humanity that he displays, and I love him because he is a paradigm of how all human beings should be. And if everyone in the world behaved and gestured the way he does, imagine. So there's something almost messianic in my feeling about Pope Francis. Now, just to say a word about the question of Jewish-Catholic relations, it seems to me that on that issue, Pope Francis hasn't really made much progress. I'm not sure what kind of progress is necessary. Theologically, I think things are in place and things have been going pretty well. On the level of the church, I would say there are some problems because of some of the bishops who were appointed by his predecessors, by John Paul II and by Pope Benedict. But then there's a third issue, and that is liturgy. And that's where I would like to see Pope Francis make some innovations. How to translate the spirit of Catholic Jewish relations from the letters of the theologians to the experience of Christian churchgoers. So that's where I would hope to see his innovation come about, and I look forward to it, and I'm sure it will come.
Kristin.
Thank you. Thanks so much for the invitation to join this esteemed panel. So real reform or window dressing. I think whereas Pope Francis's mode and pace of reform may frustrate some Catholics and unnerve others, observers more generally, window dressing, which by definition is not just attractive but superficial and misleading, I think betrays the authenticity of Francis's lived integrity and even his candor. So what I think that we see, maybe to complement the both and, a neither nor, whether neither revolutionary doctrinal reform as of yet nor window dressing, I think we see an orientation by Pope Francis of the church to the peripheries where the seeds of reform may be sown. We recall days before his election when Cardinal Bergoglio spoke to the General Congregation. He said that the church was called to come out of herself and go to the peripheries, not just geographical but existential peripheries, lest she become self-referential and sick. And I think in reorienting the church's posture and focus in this manner ever since, his praxis of encounter may be tilling the soil for real reform, attuning us to broader and more diverse sets of contexts, to new insights, and even to limitations to the tradition by modeling humility and encouraging bold dialogue. So from his primary identification of those on the periphery with the gospel to his recent attention to concrete realities facing a broad range of family lives, even his global appointments to the College of Cardinals, I think he really forefronts the church's missionary spirit. And then going to the peripheries to listen, to accompany, is reframing the church's primary concern. And I think that this posture may yet yield reforms from below, as it were. The second thing I'd like to suggest is his praxis of healing. In lowering defenses and building bridges, he's healed rifts wreaked by various borders and also rifts between gospel and culture. On his model, again, of a church as field hospital, I'd say Francis has been concerned to heal three sets of wounds: the wounds of the world, wounds of idolatry, and wounds of the church. In terms of the world, from his initial desire of a poor church for the poor to his intervention last weekend on Lesbos, Francis has really been concerned to heal victims of economic and spiritual exclusion alike. Second, wounds of idolatry. On another island, on Lampedusa, his first trip outside of Rome, he signaled how healing the wounds, in that case of migrants, had to extend beyond extending compassion or justice to migrants to really healing global indifference, healing wounds of idolatry. And I think ever since, he's lifted up structures and attitudes that harm people, that harm the planet, and he's underscored this in terms of totalizing worldviews, his technocratic paradigm, or his focus on structural causes of inequality that harm, but that also deaden us and narrow our focus of concern. And then finally, healing the wounds of the church. Beyond ongoing efforts at curial reform, he's spoken out against cultures of clericalism, theological narcissism, and I think he's repented where the church has been a part of the problem, whether in Laudato Si, over interpretations of dominion of the earth. On Lampedusa, he included himself in that prophetic repentance, or most recently in Amoris Laetitia, lifting up ways in which I think abstract norms or unhelpful interpretations of Ephesians have actually been harmful to families. I would add that I think there's still yet more healing to ensue, especially on this model of overcoming exclusion. But that Pope Francis's summons to the periphery to heal reorients the church's praxis away from preoccupation with safeguarding against risks, whether that's bright line drawing or avoiding dirty hands, and toward a culture of encounter with the good news.
Thank you, Kristin. I remind you, please, to write out your questions, and as you finish on your note card, just hold them up, and a GA will come down and pick them, come around and pick them up. Okay. Kathy.
Well, like everyone who's come before me, I think I'm going to challenge the dichotomy between real reform and window dressing with respect to the Pope. And I'm also going to suggest that one of the reasons the dichotomy needs to be challenged is that he himself is challenging that kind of a dichotomy between substance, what the core of being a Catholic is, and inessential matters about how we express it or how we talk about it or how we talk to people. He thinks that the medium is the message in many, many important ways. And I just want to highlight three areas where he's blurring the distinction between substance and form. And the first is the spirit of Vatican II. Many people have said that what the Pope is about is retrieving the spirit of Vatican II. Well, what is that spirit? The distinguished Jesuit historian John O'Malley, in his book, What Happened at Vatican II, claim that the spirit of Vatican II is in fact in the new rhetorical form that it modeled about how we talk to one another and how we treat one another as members of the same church and as members of the same community. And he said, O'Malley said that, is the literary style, that is to say, was but the surface of expression of something of Vatican II meant to sink into the very soul of the church and of every Catholic. It was much more than a tactic or a strategy, much more than simply the adoption of a more pastoral language. It was a language event. The language indicated a shift in priorities. So I think what Pope Francis is doing is recalibrating our priorities in terms of what is meant by the spirit of Vatican II. A second area where I think he's recalibrating the relationship between substance and form has to do with law and legalism. Everyone knows that this Pope is no fan of what he calls legalism. He emphasized that the gospel explains Jesus' attitude in his catechesis. Jesus taught, he said, like someone who had authority and not like the scribes or the Pharisees. They taught and preached and bound people under the heavy weights, and the poor people could not move forward. Now, with Professor Heschel on the stage, we need to acknowledge that.
Then a fist fight broke out at 5:50. So it's like
a whole other kind of effort that needs to be done in terms of Jewish Christian thought, in terms of what the Pharisees and the scribes were like. So he wasn't really, I hope, talking about the Pharisees in that context, but talking about legalistic Catholics today using the language of the Pharisees. At least that's what I'd like to think, but we can, you know, not favor that. But what's he trying?
It's going to be that kind of night.
But what is he trying to do with this language, even if he's doing so in a way that really needs some help on Jewish-Christian dialogue? What he's trying to do is reorient the point of law. It doesn't matter in and of itself, for itself. It matters to the extent it leads people to God. It helps people become better neighbors to one another and closer to God. And so he's trying to see law not as an end in itself, but as a means to a better community. The final point I think that he makes that I think is important, and maybe in fact the most revolutionary, is the relationship of pastoral practice to doctrine. Lots of people say, well, he's not changing doctrine. He's only changing pastoral practice, so don't worry about it. You can all sleep at night. Doctrine is safe in the safe. But I think what he's also suggesting is doctrine shouldn't be understood as abstract propositions unconnected to the life of the church, that doctrine finds its meaning by being able to guide and shape the practice of a community that's striving to grow closer to Christ. So whether that is calling into question an old propositional account of doctrine where each doctrine picks out a propositional truth and hangs onto it for dear life, no matter what the context, is something for the ecclesiologists to say more about. But I do see a shift there.
Thank you. As it was mentioned, I'm a journalist. The job I've always wanted was to be the headline writer at the New York Post.
Maid says Klaus is Laus.
So what I'm going to do is give you a series of headlines or bullet points that I'm not going to be able to develop extensively, but I think begin to give us a feel for where Pope Francis's theology is coming from. The first thing is it's pastoral. It's not abstract. It's prophetic. It's not academic. He does not write like an academic theologian. He writes like an op-ed writer. That's the way he writes. And that's a big difference between him and the last two popes. He does not pretend to be an academic or a systematic theologian in terms of his presentation. He is interested more in orthopraxis rather than orthodoxy. For him, it's all about Matthew 25. When, you know, the last judgment's going to be about when I was hungry, you gave me food, when I was thirsty, you clothed me, not can you define transubstantiation? And can you explain it? That, I think, is important. He's not ideological. That's another thing about this man. He's, you know, his background was as a scientist. He was trained as a chemist. The difference between a scientist and a philosopher and theologian is that if a scientist has a theory and it doesn't fit reality, he knows he has to change his theory. If a philosopher or a theologian has a theory and it doesn't fit reality, reality has to change.
We don't know anybody like that.
So he's not ideological. Facts matter to this man. And you saw that in the opening of the encyclical on the environment. The first chapter is, what does science tell us? And the second chapter of his apostolic exhortation on the family, the second chapter is, what is the situation of families today? Facts matter to this pope. I think one of the revolutionary things about his theology in terms of moral theology that we find in chapter 8 of Amoris Laetitiae is that he is moving the church from a rule-based morality to a discernment-based reality. And I'll let the experts here explain that to you, but that is really important. That chapter 8 should be read by every confessor and used in every moral theology class in seminaries and around the world. It is really an important change. If he was teaching a course in theology, what would he be teaching? Catholic social teaching, probably. Spirituality, yeah. Ecclesiology, yes. He's not going to teach sacraments or liturgy. He doesn't have much to say about those topics.
And besides, he's a Jesuit.
Exactly. you know, he's not a John Baldwin, you know. So he does, you know, he just doesn't have much to say. In terms of how revolutionary he is, he says he's a son of the church. And so he's not going to question. He's not ready to do battle with some of the doctrinal things that, you know, that's kind of his answer that comes up, is I'm a son of the church. But he's open to development. At the synod on the family, he had this statement. He was getting complaints. People were saying, you know, the cardinals, they're all arguing. This is terrible. He says, relax. Quote, open and fraternal debate makes theological and pastoral thought grow. That doesn't frighten me. What's more, I look for it. He fosters it, this kind of open discussion. We haven't had that since Vatican II. So this is, again, a big change. And finally, this is a pope who does not want to be the answer man in terms of theology. In the apostolic exhortation, he says, in the very beginning of it, he states that quote, "Not all discussions of doctrinal, moral, or pastoral issues need to be settled by intervention of the magisterium," close quote. So he's quite comfortable with things being open and you know, and debated and in controversy. This is fine. You know, he looks like a Jesuit sitting around the rec room with a beer, you know, in the middle of an argument.
Not that Jesuits ever sit with a beer and argue. Right.
Anyway, those are my headlines.
Mark Rashawn.
The hard part about going last, of course, is I agree with everything that's been said, so I'm going to try to search for a couple things that haven't been said. One, and I want to be careful about this, he's from Latin America. And this is sometimes used to minimize him and to relativize him. Oh, he doesn't understand the economy because he's from Argentina. You know, and I was on a debate at the Cato Institute, of all places, this libertarian think tank. And this guy's spouting this. Well, he doesn't understand capitalism the way we have it. He only knows the crony capitalism of Argentina. I said, now, wait a minute. He's the Pope. He's the universal pastor of the church. No one ever said, we know Benedict is from this snow globe village in Bavaria. So, you know, so let's just cut that. That said, and it follows up on some of the points that were made, there is a different approach to how the church does its business that has emerged since the Council in Latin America. And so the fact that a synod is not run from the top, where everybody gives these talks and there's actually no dialogue, and you actually start with trying to have consultation. You know, before a meeting of Salem, the consultation at the parish and base community level starts 3 years in advance. So he's bringing this experience.
Why don't you tell them what Salem is for those?
Oh, Salem, the continent-wide meeting of the Latin American Bishops' Conference, which meets every 10 years. So this is what he knows, but he knows that it works. Another part of the Latin American thing, which I think ties up some of the themes here, is I think you could say in a nutshell that if for the last 35 years, pastoral theology was considered a subset of moral theology, he has reversed that. And moral theology now has to serve pastoral theology, as does every other branch of theology. And I think this is a key hermeneutic for understanding them. The only other thing, and I'm surprised two Jesuits on the table have not mentioned this, because I think it is a key to understanding him, especially for us Americans. He's an old Jesuit. And what do old Jesuits do? They fight Jansenists. The American Catholic Church, I say this, Michael Shawn, you know, my mother Claire Eileen McDermott was a Jansenist through and through. Bless her heart, she's gone to God. And his commitment to conscience, to freedom, this was the fight that the Jesuits had with the Jansenists back then.
Explain what Jansenism is.
Jansenists were crypto Calvinists, but they were Catholic, with a particular emphasis on sexual purity. Sound familiar? National Catholic Register? Okay, EWTN? So, you know, this has been our experience.
No, I'm not saying this. He's saying that.
No, and it's and it's not just EWTN. It is, you know, that there's a certain Jansenism in Irish Catholic history. I grew up with it. So I think it's, and this is what he is doing. But it really goes to, if you go back to the history of Jansenism, I'm not an expert on that by any means, but I think the core issue really had to do with freedom, conscience, versus this rules-based, you're not free, in this crypto-Calvinism, God has ordained it, and your success or failure will be a manifestation of whether you're in the elect. I don't think he's particularly concerned. I was reading just today in Tornielli's new book, that in 2009, he spoke to a Caritas group, and he upbraided the Caritas is the international charitable organization for the Holy See, and he upbraided them because he had heard that they had just had a birthday party for one of their staff members, and they had gone to this swanky restaurant. And he said, if you care for the poor, you have to love the poor, and if you really love them, you have to join them. And when he says he wants a poor church for the poor, it's not an ideological construct. It's not a political program. It's not an NGO strategy. I think he means it. And that's my last point. The question I get asked more than any other is, why does he put up with the opposition? And the opposition is strong. And it is on everything. The good thing is they all hate each other more than they hate him. But the reason people who
Isn't it great to be a Catholic? You know,
the reason, that's an old story. William Henry O'Connell, okay, who was the Cardinal Archbishop of this city, when he was being installed in 1906, 1908, and he was asked, how could you, they all hated you. And how did you have the courage to walk into that cathedral and take possession? He said, well, first, I had said my prayers that morning. Second, I had the papal bull in my pocket. And third, they all hated each other more than they hated me. But anyway, so, but I would just say this. I think he believes it. What he says about mercy, what he says about conversion, what he says about seeing Christ in the other, I think when he sits down with a cardinal who is opposing him, he tries to put that into action. And he feels it's his job to bring them along, not just to fire them and put in his team. Now, I do think there's going to be some shakeups with the team because there's some organizational changes. But it is remarkable that certain cardinals who quite openly have opposed him are still in office, and I think he believes it.
Great. I remind you, put up your hand if you have a question, have a card, so go to the Jays. Jansenism is an obsession with the sixth and the ninth commandments. So whenever I hear confessions and I come back to the Jesuit community, they say, how was it? I said, lots of six of nines today. And they said, well, there are a bunch of Jansenists in this parish, you know. So, okay, I always measure who I go to after these things by the person who looked at me the most. And Susannah looked at me the most during this. So do you want to
yes.
start your response?
Yes, okay, I do want to respond.
Why do I think scribes and Pharisees is going to be part of this?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so this quotation referring to Pharisees, which is problematic, it sounds like the sort of thing that Abel Schur would have written in the 19th century. And I had this problem when I was asked to write a blurb for an English translation of a book that Pope Francis, when he was cardinal, wrote together with Rabbi Skorka in Argentina. And I read the manuscript and I thought, no. Same old, yeah? And I didn't give it a blurb. I didn't want to give it a blurb. So I think, in fact, on this issue, he's not, let's say, intellectually as advanced as one might hope in the 21st century, and I think it's a problem. I also don't think it's on his agenda, on his radar right now. Fine, but let's be aware of that. Okay, then I want to say something in response to Matthew 25. You know what worried me about this, your comment? It worried me that we have hovering over us the ghost of Adolf Harnack and liberal Protestantism. And I would not want to see Catholic theology devolve into liberal Protestantism. Jesus is teaching us about the Father, and he's a good teacher, and so forth. So a little bit too much of that can be disturbing. Now, on your point, I would say, what worries me is the gesture is wonderful. The mercy he shows, the kind of human being. I admire him enormously. I don't know, when have we seen such a person on this earth? On the other hand, unless he writes it down and makes it very clear, what's the legacy? It can be overturned too easily. And we desperately need him to make it very concrete. So,
Michael Sean, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, I think
question?
His immediate response would be, hey, the Holy Spirit's got to be in charge of his church, not me, would be part of it. And clearly, the right thought this was going to be a very short pontificate. You know, Cardinal Casper last year said...
Well, he said it's going to be short.
Yeah, and Cardinal Casper, though, said, you know, the right just views this pontificate like a bit of bad weather, and they're just waiting to get to the other side. I don't think there's any going back. First of all, who would want to be the... Who would want that job? I'm the Pope to dial it back? You'd be the most hated person in the world. So I don't think there's going back. And I think he's had two consistories. This year is a big year. There's 14 cardinals who age out. Who hit 80. So he can appoint 14 more electors. He's already appointed 30. That's 44. He's getting up to that point. And we have to remember, the base there was the group that elected him. Now, I think some were a little surprised at what they got. I think he may have been surprised at how it's turned out.
This comes under the general rubric, be careful what you pray for. Right?
Exactly. But I don't think there's... I don't know that there's any going back. And this was apparent within the Curia about 3 months after Cardinal Turkson came from Rome. He's the prefect of the Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace. And we were having dinner, a group of us, and he was talking about, you know, how when he first got there, he's from Ghana, and they said, well, you're a cardinal. You have to have this fancy card. He didn't want it. They said, you have to, and all these kinds of things. And he just said, but now with Pope Francis, I'll tell you this, the red shoes are never coming back.
Is that the name of your book?
But you know, they'll be a great
So Jim, I'm sorry, Kathy, go.
Well, I mean, I wish I were as optimistic. I think if somebody wants to bring back the red shoes and they're as charismatic as Pope Francis is, but in a different direction, they'll find a way to do it. They'll find a way to reframe it. Where I see the problem with writing it down is that writing it down in one way is what got us into trouble in the first place. I actually think a history of the effect of the new catechism is kind of what got us into some trouble, because anybody with a truculent attitude, a copy of the catechism, and an internet connection can be a theologian these days. And what they do is they tend to read every item in the catechism as having absolutely the same level of authority, and they think it's self-interpreting. At least in the old days when you had a propositional theology, you had theologians go through the text with Denzinger and give each its appropriate weight. But now we've got this kind of level fundamentalism. So writing it down, I don't know how, I'm not so sure that's going
to
help.
This seems to be a theme, and I want everyone to talk about this. Can we dial it back when the Pope retires or dies, God forbid anytime soon, but could it be dialed back?
Well, if a cardinal who hails from my home state of Wisconsin...
Don't go any further than that.
...should be elected, I predict he will choose as his name Pius the 13th, and he will dial it back. But I don't think he's electable. So I think the next pope is, when he comes out on the loggia of St. Peter's, I think he's going to conduct himself in his first public appearance, which might be, you know, window dressing, very much the way Pope Francis did. I don't think we're going to go back to the, you know, the red Mozzetta with the ermine trim and, you know, my brothers and sisters. And, you know, when Pope Francis came out, I was on the phone with one of the media people, and he came out and he said, "Buonasera." And I thought, well, that's awfully folksy. it's like saying...
That's not what he actually said.
But no, he did. No, Pope Francis said what he said. Yeah. It's like saying, hi. In Italian, you know, I would never have come out saying that. But, and I said initially, I said, does he not know Italian well enough to say, you know, carissimi fratelli e sorelle, sono contento di, you know, something like that. And then as he went on, I said, no, he speaks Italian quite fluently. It's a strange accent. And I checked with my Italian colleague, Andrea Vicini, who is from Italy. I said, what accent is it? He says, well, I'm not sure. But it's fluent, but it is very personal, and it's a different mode. And I think the next pope is going to have to try to, in some way or another, approximate that mode.
So, Susannah, you're clearly worried about dialing back, unless it's written down?
I actually think another Ratzinger could easily enjoy turning things around. But I'd rather be optimistic against my better judgment.
I want to make sure, and this comes up a lot, Ratzinger, I think, got an unnecessarily bad name because he just had horrible PR and didn't know how to work it at all. Certainly, his conduct in the pontificate of Francis has been exemplary.
Yes.
Okay? During the first synod, a group of cardinals went to Benedict and said, you need to speak to this man, Francis. And he did two things. We always say cum Petro et sub Petro, with Peter and under, and he reversed it. Sub Petro et cum Petro, took down their names, sent them away, and called Francis and gave him the names. So two cheers for Ratzinger. I also think when you look at the social teaching, you see important seeds in Ratzinger and important seeds in John Paul. One of the things that we have got to do is understand John Paul was a much more complicated figure than George Weigel says he was. George Weigel thought he was an American neocon, and he wasn't. Now, I have my problems with John Paul, but on the social teachings of the church, he was much more sophisticated than he was interpreted. So I want us to be a little... There are elements of continuity in among these pontificates, as well as the obvious areas of discontinuity.
Kristin?
Well, I was just going to respond to two things that Tom raised, and I'm not sure how to connect it now to will we dial it back, except for that the first thing is the prophetic characterization that you made, because I think sometimes, especially when he gets on airplanes and gives freewheeling interviews, people get nervous that Pope Francis is prophetic in the sense of dismissible and loose canon and disruptive iconoclast, and so that's where I think you could run the risk of seeing this as just an aberration. And I hope I'm getting this right, but I think I've used in the past Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel's understanding of prophet more in terms of being attuned to the divine pathos and seeking to console and defend the poor. That's the kind of prophet or prophetic mood of Francis that I see. And I guess I hope that that's an enduring one. I also think this notion of Vatican II that Kathy raised and conscience that Tom touched on is also really important in terms of moving forward. I think he's the first pope not to have participated in the council of his immediate predecessors. I remember his interview with Anthony Spadaro where he says he expected some long-winded answer about the effects of Vatican II and the legacy, and he gets this really short answer as if he just takes for granted, like you said, O'Malley's kind of mode or voice of Vatican II, the how of the church rather than the what. He says, sure, there's hermeneutics of continuity and discontinuity, but the sense of the signs of the times living out the gospel is absolutely irreversible. And I think there, this kind of personalist notion of conscience that came out, I remember when his interview with the Italian atheist that raised all these concerns about subjectivism and people are always concerned about cafeteria Catholicism was really underscored in this document that's not even 2 weeks old yet, right? That the church is called to form consciences, not replace them. So I just agree that that accent on a personalist notion of conscience and shaping freedom is very strong, and I hope not readily reversible.
If you leave tonight and remember nothing, remember that phrase that she just said in the document. The church is here to form consciences, not to replace them. Okay, so
Kathy, dial back. Not you personally. No.
I am all in favor of the church forming consciences and not replacing consciences. But as an ethicist, you know, I do also think that part of the discernment and the collective discernment we're engaged in as members of the church and with all people of goodwill is to actually reflect on whether what we're teaching is correct, or whether there in fact needs to be development on some key issues. And what I had hoped Pope Francis is in favor of development. How do we reflect and discern responsibly as a community about what the shape of that development should be? The darker side of conscience as an invocation is that it can be used as an escape valve. Sort of like, well, it's all up to your conscience. We don't really need to rethink the rule or rethink the application. We're just going to punt to conscience. And I hope we don't do that.
Tom?
Can it be dialed back? Sure. All we have to do is look at what happened after Vatican II and John the 23rd. I think that, you know, the papacies of John Paul II and Benedict were, I don't always think of them as dialing back. I think they did dial back on collegiality. Benedict tried to dial back on liturgy a bit. But there are other things that simply, it was too late. The ships left the port, and it's not coming back. There was no way they could put the liturgy back into Latin. There was no way they could, reverse generations of commitment of the church to Catholic social teaching. These things are here to stay.
Relationships
with non-Christians, the improvement with the Jews, and improvement with Protestants. These things are just part of the church. And on top of that, you have the gradual, not so gradual anymore, the education of the laity. I mean, it was fine when the priest was the smartest man in the village. It ain't anymore. You know, it simply is not the case anymore. And then finally, we're still going to face the problem of a declining number of priests. Now, I've frequently said that maybe God knows what she's doing, and this is the only way to declericalize the Catholic Church, by having, you know, a couple of papacies that said no to women priests, no to married priests, no to gay priests. So who's going to be a priest? And once the priests are gone, well, the laity just have to step forward. I mean, clericalism is a two-sided coin. It's the priests who want to tell you what to do, and it's the laity who wants Father to do everything for them. So this world is changing. I mean, John Paul, for example, at the beginning of his papacy through Ratzinger, could really try and get a grip on theology, on theologians, I should say. And they could kind of do that because most of them were priests or religious. Ain't so anymore. You know, you can grab them by their vow of obedience.
Not another part of their anatomy.
Yeah, and you can order them here or there, but you know, you can't do that to a tenured lay professor who's writing and speaking about theology. They are free, and there's all the clerical control in the world is not going to stop them from speaking out. So there's, you know, there's a lot of horses out of the barn that any reversal is going to be very, very hard to pull off.
Well, just one word about why I think writing it down is helpful. Many years ago, I was teaching at SMU. And down the road at the University of Dallas, the students had put on a production of The Merchant of Venice. And it was a really hideous portrayal of Shylock, a really anti-Semitic production. And so a few of us were called to speak to the students. And when I read to them those short texts from Nostra Aetate concerning the Jews, they were shocked. They thought I was reading them heresy. Where did that come from? It's from the Vatican. This is your church. You have to accept this and believe this. And they were really taken aback. So first of all, it helps to have that text. Thank goodness for that text. But then the other issue is, how do you translate the text or the gesture into liturgy? And that's really where I think some innovation has to be.
It's too bad you weren't wearing a clerical collar when you did that, actually. So it's like, speaking of priests, though, first question from the audience is, I'll be ordained a priest for the Diocese of St. Petersburg in about a month. What advice do you offer on being a Pope Francis priest?
Sunscreen.
He's on my faculty. I've learned from him.
When Pope Francis was in charge of Jesuit formation in Buenos Aires, he used to send the seminarians down into the slums, into the, on the weekends. And when they came back, he'd look at their shoes. If their shoes were still shiny, he knew they had not had a good experience. They had to come back with dirty shoes. So I guess, you know, if we're going to be true to Pope Francis, we have to really we have to take serious that trinity of things that he says of serving the poor, accompanying the poor, and defending or advocating for the poor. And you know, serving the poor means, you know, the traditional acts of charity that the church has done for centuries. Advocating and defending is, you know, the works of social justice and politics. But, you know, middle class America finds it pretty easy to write a check and to write a letter to their congressman, and then they can, their conscience is clean. That middle one is the stumper, the accompany. What that means is sitting down and getting to know a poor person by name, looking them in the eyes and having a conversation with them, becoming friends with them. welcoming them into your home, into your community. I think that's what he wanted his seminarians to do when they went down into the slums, you know, to really get to know the poor as people. And I think that's extremely important. The last thing I would say is memorize chapter 8 of Amoris Laetitiae.
Yeah. There's going to be a test later on tonight. So like,
Kathy? What's striking to me, if you think about the past three popes, is neither Pope John Paul II nor Pope Benedict, I mean, obviously they didn't have children, but they didn't have nieces or nephews. Either, you know, they were in a situation where there was no child in the next generation that they could say, well, yeah, you're a pope, but you're my uncle, you know, so I'm going to tell you what I think. Whereas this pope does have a broader extended family, and so I would say, and I think that there's a realness that he expresses that comes from the fact that he has a lot of people in his life who knew him when, you know, who
would be. So your advice to this young man who's going to be ordained would be?
I would advise them to keep in contact with the members of their family who are going to keep them from being clericals and who will tell them the truth about what's going on in the high schools, in the colleges, in the young marriages of this country.
And all those weddings being done by the Church of Universal Humanism, or was it two Saturdays ago, it was in the New York Times, it was the Church of the Divine Dude, you know. So, Kristin, you were going to say.
Yeah,
that.
I like these pieces of advice: muddy shoes and keep in contact with your straight-talking nephews. But I was thinking of one of. I was with one of Pope Francis's appointees now in San Diego recently, Robert McElroy, now Archbishop of San Diego, and I was remembering that he wrote early on about this disconnect between who Pope Francis was calling the church to and some of what he observed in the U.S. church. And I think one of his pieces, so I want to have two pieces of advice, one from his words and one from his actions. From his words, I think he's right that Pope Francis's invitation away from kind of preoccupation with culture war issues and toward this sense of, quote his tweet, inequality is the root of all social evil, right? Really reorients the priorities, this accompaniment with the poor, for the newly ordained, for all of us, but in this case to give advice. And he's written, I think, powerfully about ways in which it's easier for us to write a check, like Tom said, right? Ways in which that we can dismiss, if not as crony capitalism, as misguided or naive or impractical, the real call that makes on us in a society like the US. So to really take that seriously, Michael Shun's point, he actually means it. The other thing that interested me is that in San Diego in the fall, Bishop McElroy is doing an experiment of a little mini synod, kind of on the model of the synod on the family. And he said, raising this with his priest, he could tell, and he's new to the area, he's gone around, and so he's consulted and listened. He said, I could tell it's really puzzled them that I want to do this. And I think they're willing to go along with it, but it's puzzling to them. So I think for the newly ordained, also kind of taking seriously this mode of consultation that I think this is a nice model of, even if it takes experimentation or hearing voices that you don't want to hear that are going to tell you like it is.
Your advice would be don't be afraid to this person going to be ordained to priest. Don't be afraid to experiment with something.
Yeah, and to actually listen and consult and not fear that mode.
Yeah, I would say that for many of the clerics that I know, the ears are purely decorative, you know, and they're not really attached. So I think listen. Listen to people. A good beginning. I'm sorry.
I don't want to put you on the spot wherever you are, the seminarian who's going to be ordained for St. Petersburg, but my advice is, quote, cumque dixit facite. Do whatever he tells you, because your bishop, Bob Lynch, is one of the outstanding bishops in the entire United States. You're only going to have him for another few years. And I have a new criteria for what makes a great bishop in the United States. He reads my column every morning. But he's a great guy. You are very, very lucky to have him.
I don't think that's self-interested at all. Do you want to say
well,
Other than sunscreen?
Yeah. I teach a course in confessional ministry that all the seminarians in our school have to take. Most of them really are very serious about trying to mediate God's mercy. In an appropriate way. They want to do the best they can. There always is a little cadre, unfortunately, in my view, unfortunately, that see their role as rule enforcers and calling people to judgment. And I think that that's truly unfortunate. And the other thing, if you're a new priest, remember what I used to say, and I'll repeat it again, whatever you didn't know 30 minutes before you're ordained, you're not going to know 30 minutes after you're ordained. That, you know, the grace of the sacrament doesn't operate in that way. So a little epistemological humility can go a long way pastorally.
Right. Good advice. It's a question about women. As well, Pope Francis has shifted the paradigm to listening and encounter with so many other issues, he has not invited Catholic women, at least publicly, to advise him, and then goes on to ask questions about the role of women in the church. What do you think Pope Francis's position is or understanding is of women in the church who make up, last in the United States, I think 64% of the Catholic population are female. Go ahead, I dare you. No.
I think he has a pro attitude toward women. You know, I mean, in the sense that he likes women, he believes that they should be in the church, and he thinks they have a contribution to make. But I don't think he's seriously engaged. You know, the questions of sexism and of what that might mean in a deeper way. I think he sort of looked at it, even if he's opposed to women's ordination, I don't think he's thought about how sexism isn't just reduced to that question, but, you know, it pertains to patterns of leadership and inclusion that are much broader than that. I don't think he has a bad will, but I really would like him to spend maybe 2 hours with Margaret Farley.
So your advice is drive the Pope to New Haven, to Yale, lock him in a room with Margaret Farley.
She's in Guilford on the beach.
Okay. Okay.
Well, I think that Pope Francis has at least 4 strikes against him. First of all, he's a man. Any man who thinks he can say anything about women today needs his head examined. The best thing that men can do is listen, you know, listen to women and what they have to say. So that's, I think, is the first strike against him. The second is he's a celibate male. And I'm not saying that men who have sex with women suddenly magically understand women better than before. I don't think there's any empirical evidence for that. But I think it does connect to what Kristin was saying, is if you have a wife, she tends to talk straight to you. And if you have some daughters, they'll say, hey, come on, Dad, get real. You know, I mean, you get a little feedback that celibate clerics do not get. The third thing, he's from Latin America, and I don't want to sound stereotyping, but it's a patriarchal culture, and that's where he comes from. The other thing is that he has no understanding of feminist theology that's developed in the last generation in the first world. He doesn't been in the faculty lounge of Boston College. And I mean, you know, you can't be at a university faculty and not get educated on feminist issues. You can't. So, but
there might be a place at Boston College. I'm not aware of that place.
Yeah. I mean, he just simply hasn't had that kind of experience. Now, what can I say? And, you know, that's the negative. What's the positive? Clearly, you know, even though he's from Latin America, he's from a country that's had a, you know, a woman president. Eva Perón was a pretty powerful lady, more powerful than any woman in the United States has ever been. So, you know, he's seen women in very powerful roles in his culture, in his political life. The current president of Argentina is a woman. His first job as a young man was a woman was his boss. And he became very close to her. And they became very good friends. He considered her his mentor. And so this was an extremely positive relationship. The other thing I would say is for him, you know, he is concerned about women's issues, but he's concerned about women's issues in the third world. When he went down to the slums and sat in the homes of women, what did they tell, what did they say to him? It wasn't the glass ceiling, you know, not becoming a full partner in the law firm. It was, I'm worried about my daughter being kidnapped on the way home from school and being trafficked. That's what she's worrying about. I'm worried because, you know, my husband's got to leave now, you know, and go to North America or go somewhere else because he can't get a job. And I can't get a job. How am I going to feed my kids? These are the concerns of women in the third world. And so, you know, as Archbishop of Buenos Aires, he, you know, became a leader in the movement against human trafficking. And he brought, wisely brought a woman in to advise him and lead him on that. And I met her in Washington at a conference. And so, of course, I asked her, I said, what was it like working for Bergoglio? And she said, oh, it was wonderful. He did whatever I told him. So, you know, he seems to, you know, have a respect for intelligent, powerful women. But when he opens his mouth and starts talking about women, I can just hear the teeth grinding.
Flowers on the cake?
Yes, I see it on the cake. And even in this latest apostolic exhortation, he condemns male chauvinism. He even condemns patriarchal culture. But then he's got a whole passage where he says, you know, the church loves big families. And that women, you know, should stay home, especially in the first months of a child's birth. Now, if he had just added one more line saying, and that's why we should have paternal leave as part of employment policy, he could have redeemed himself. But nobody told him to put in that line. And so it's just that's out there all by itself without, you know, identifying what's the, you know, a lot of women would like to stay home.
There are little postcards in the back
anyway,
of this building.
I've talked too long.
You're supposed to fill them out and write to the Vatican and ask the Pope to take Tom Reese as his personal advisor.
So it's mixed.
Can I echo some of this? I agree. He's said some, I keep dropping my mic. He said some unfortunate things, strawberries on the cake for the few appointments. I guess that was the International Theological Commission. Or this need for a deeper theology of women, which betrays the fact that he hasn't read, you know, in the last several decades of feminist theology. And I think that those comments also betray that that deeper theology of women need not meaningfully contest some of this complementarity or separate spheres. He talks about women being valued, not clericalized. I'm with Kathy. I think he's pro-women. I do think that there's a disconnect that maybe needs shoring up, maybe to your first point. I think reading this latest apostolic exhortation, I see some signs of progress, but I think some of that essentialism is pretty much still intact. So I do want to lift up, we see in the women's movement the working of the Spirit, and we shouldn't blame women's emancipation for the objectification of women in all of these ways. And yet the passage where he starts to talk about breaking down gender stereotypes, that it might not be masculine to help out when the woman has a job outside the home. And for a global church, maybe that is a giant leap forward. And I think the grinding of the teeth I may be guilty of to say that assumes this maybe slightly higher bar, lower bar essentialism, but that assumes complementary roles and a special maternal genius.
I was just going to add, and he does have that wonderful line about this, you know, testifying that the Spirit was alive and well and moving in the women's movement.
Yes.
That was spectacular.
To pick up on Kristin's last point, if you look at what was said at the synod, some of the voices that did not make it into the apostolic exhortation, I think that's a helpful interpretive lens. So there were a number of hierarchs, like Cardinal Serra from Africa, who called gender ideology the new Satanism. I mean, I'm not making this up. He did say that. And that did not find its way into the text. And if you take the text and then, you know, cherry pick something from the theology of the body of John Paul II, or, you know, some of his writings about women, there really is a shift. And for someone, you know, I was 7 years in Rome, that is used to looking into the minutiae to see where the paradigm might beginning to nudge a bit, I think it's nudged. But I think you're right in terms of personal experience. He's behind a bit of the learning curve, and the first world concerns are not the Latin American concerns, you know, point for point.
I have a question for Susannah. I mean, obviously the Roman Catholic Church is an all-male celibate priesthood. Do non-Christian traditions have this, the women in non-Christian traditions have the same kind of issues with the clergy?
Well, you know, what I find remarkable is that in my lifetime, I've seen women suddenly become ordained as rabbis in the Reform movement in 1972, conservative 1983, and now Orthodox women. That's remarkable. And on the other hand, we have a Jewish religious newspaper, Hamodia, that excises any picture of a female. So the famous picture of President Obama sitting with the Secretary of State Clinton when they were getting the news that Osama bin Laden had been killed, they cut her picture out when they printed it. What are they going to do when she becomes president? I don't know. But I would just want to say what I find bizarre, and I really don't understand, why is it when they were preparing for the Second Vatican Council and they asked bishops all over the world to write something, what do you want us to discuss? Thousands of pages, not one mentioned Jews or Judaism. Not one, not from America, from Europe. And yet, boom, it happened, just like that, and an incredible revolutionary statement, Nostra Aetate. How did that happen? And on the other hand, we have all this feminist theology, so many women theologians and professors and so on. What's happening? When Pope John Paul II greeted visiting bishops, he would always say to them, what are you doing for Jewish-Christian relations? He encouraged them. Why do we have centers all over, including here at Boston College, a Center for Christian Jewish Learning? Why don't we have such centers for male-female learning, let's say? Why don't we have that kind of effort? Why is it the liturgy could be modified, the Good Friday liturgy, the catechism with an eye to Judaism? Why is that I have students who, when I teach them something about the Middle Ages, something like the Jews killed Jesus, and they say, what do you mean the Jews killed Jesus? The Romans killed Jesus. They never even heard it. That's a remarkable change. Why hasn't this happened with women? Why has no effort been made? Why aren't there such centers all over the world? Why hasn't there been liturgical reform like this and a statement like Nostra Aetate and so on? It happened at the same time in the 60s. What is it?
I have an international phone and on the way out to dinner afterwards, Susanna's going to call her holiness. His holiness. Microphone, do you mind? Okay, good. The question's here about, what does Pope Francis's papacy ask of the church in the United States? Especially, this has come up a number of times, that he's from South America, you know, he is behind in terms of learning the kind of feminist theology that's been going. I would say we're, what, third or fourth generation feminist now in theology, something like that. What do you think Pope Francis makes of Catholicism in the United States, and what would you think he would want us to do, especially with the Hispanic community?
I'll jump in first. I think, you know, he is acutely aware of the problems with the U.S. church, this idea that he, you know, doesn't really know what's going on. And I think you see this most obviously in the appointment of Blaise Zupich as the Archbishop of Chicago, where this is a guy who was on no one's radar screen and got pulled out basically on Cardinal Oscar's and Cardinal O'Malley's recommendation and said, this is the guy, and he went with it. And that would not have happened beforehand.
In Chicago, for those of us on the East Coast, don't realize Chicago is the big archdiocese. That's the one.
And it's, so I think you're seeing some change. Now, here's where it gets tricky. One of the things I think generally people are in favor of is the idea that we will devolve authority away from Rome to the local and national church. I hope that doesn't happen too quickly in the United States till we get about 40 more Francis bishops. Because if that were to happen tomorrow, the current bishops' conference, the staff, the leadership, they are not on board. You know, this is, you know, Cardinal Dolan, the past president, and Cardinal DiNardo, who will become the president in November, both signed the letter at the beginning of the synod attacking the synod. So, I mean, this is, you know, this is not conjecture that there's some opposition there. This is part of my worry, and it ties in also to the clerical lay. It is one of the NCR, our NCR, is one of the things for 60 years is we need more lay involvement, you know. Be careful what you ask for. The Catholic left is not nearly as organized.
Or as rich.
Not nearly as well-funded. Who do you think, if the lay people had more say in the U.S. church, it would be Knights of Columbus, George Weigel. So be very careful what you ask for. I don't think lay control actually, I think the lay faithful can be a pain in the butt.
In one sense, there's great vitality. In another sense, in the last religious census, which is in 2010, the three largest religious orders in the three largest religious groups in descending order are evangelical Protestants, Catholics, former Catholics.
Right.
Former Catholics are now the third largest religious groups.
What I think Pope Francis is trying to tell us, I mean, is really to get back to the core of the gospel message, which is for both people in the developed world and in the developing world, good news. Be an evangelist. I think so many of our bishops, unfortunately, have been what I call cuckangelists, to take the Greek, bad news givers, not good news givers. It's this totally dispiriting sense, that's conjoined with, you know, the terrible sex abuse crisis, but also with the politicization of the Catholic Church in the United States, and the sense that if you're not voting for the correct political party, you know, you're condemned to lose your membership in the church. I think a lot of those things have just totally been bad news, dispirited the country and its Catholics. And I think what Pope Francis wants is to get back to the good news message. You know, Jesus, you know, God loved us and sent his only son to teach us, yes, but also to redeem us and to help each other on the path toward redemption. So,
at the synod, two American hierarchs got up in indifferent relatio, said, we have to pay more attention to the 99. We can't just be focused on the one. One of the hierarchs was Archbishop Charles Chaput from Philadelphia, and the other one was His Eminence Cardinal Dolan from New York City. One of the lines in the apostolic exhortation that I took great delight in was the Holy Father saying, there's 100 sheep in the flock, not just 99. All belong to the flock. And I don't think that line found its way in the text by accident.
I would say the kind of fortress mentality or the bunker mentality that Kathy's comments remind me of is being challenged by Pope Francis in the U.S. church. But also, I think that's not unrelated to some of his messages when he was here in the fall, kind of sociopolitically and economically. I think this sense with this election season of building walls rather than bridges, to use his line, is really thoroughgoing. It's not just kind of what's this political candidate's position on immigration reform and why does Francis keep talking about it and having pesky prophetic encounters with refugees and migrants. But rather,
and bringing them back to Rome.
But rather, how is that really preoccupying the U.S. mentality? So I found his speech to the Congress on that really moving in a way, and his cross-border liturgy really moving. I mean, how are we preoccupied with our own security in a whole host of ways and our own fears, both as church and as Americans, in a way that blocks this thrust to the peripheries, this encounter.
I just want to say that what's so remarkable to me about the United States compared to any other country, how diverse we are religiously, and how much we talk to each other, and how many people change their religious affiliations and beliefs and commitments during the course of a single lifetime. I was once a visiting professor at the University of Frankfurt in the Faculty of Protestant Theology, and there was a Faculty of Catholic Theology in the same building. They had nothing to do with one another. They didn't talk, they didn't share, they didn't go to each other's lectures, nothing. It wouldn't happen here. So there's a kind of diversity that we have that I think is quite extraordinary, and that's what gives rise to the liveliness. I think we are a country, I would say Catholics in the United States, Catholics raise questions more than any other Catholic community elsewhere in the world. I think it's extraordinary. You raise questions.
Maybe I'll try and sum it up by saying that I think the Pope is speaking to at least three groups in the church, you know, the clerics. And he's very anti-clerical. You know, it's don't act like princes. You know, you're
jerks.
At the bottom of the pyramid, not at the top. You're to serve. And your message, the first words out of your mouth and the words that should be constantly coming out of your mouth is the good news that of God's mercy and compassion, not these are the rules you need to follow to become to be a good Catholic. So I think that's a message to the clergy. The message to the people in the pews, I think he pulled his punches when he came here. I really do. Because I think he sees us as the richest and the most powerful country in the world, and that we got to dial back. I mean, if you read his encyclical, it's quite clear when he talks about carbon debt, for example. Who has prospered because of the carbon economy for the last 100 years? Who's been pumping carbon into the air? Well, who now owes a debt to the rest of the world because of that? It's us. And he has things talking about changing the whole economic system. From a consumer-based economy to a more, taking care of the common good, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, these are incredibly challenging things that he has to say. And it's not just the 1%. It's the other 80% below them that are going to have to take a hit. And that's us. And I think he dialed it back when he came here. Then the third group, I think, is as you said, you know, the 10% of the U.S. population that are ex-Catholics. One out of three people who were raised Catholics have left the church. Or at least, you know, when they're asked, what is your religion, they say, I was a Catholic, but I'm not anymore. One out of three people. I think his message to them is, yeah, you're part of the 100, as you said. You're part, you know, in my mind, you're still one of us, and I love you, and I want you to be part of us. I want to welcome you. I want you to be in as much in the church as you want to be in the church. And
maybe just the one way of thinking about that is he's not in favor of the smaller, purer church model.
No, no.
That some people attributed to Benedict, though other people say that Benedict was predicting it, not calling for it. But it's fair enough to say that a lot of Benedict's, you know, self-professed admirers, you know, thought a smaller, purer church was a very
leaner,
good thing.
Leaner, meaner, especially meaner. Yeah.
The only thing that we have to throw in demographically here is from Professor Espino's last report, said of Catholics under the age of 18, 61% are Latino. That's, you know, I mean, so the demographic future is already here. We have not gotten our head around this, but that is going to bring a different Catholicism, which has never been as reliant on clergy. They've always had a shortage of clergy in Latin America. It's a totally different experience, much more culturally enfleshed. And it is the only thing that will keep the Catholic Church in this country from becoming and dying as an upper middle class club. I mean, this is, without the Latinos, just turn off the lights. It's no longer interesting.
The only problem I have with that argument, you know, is that after two, three generations, they adapt to the culture. And they leave just as fast as the others do. So, I think we have to acknowledge that they are there and they're very important. And the church has to change because they're there. But they're not going to save us. Not unless.
Okay, we have 10 minutes left. We're going to do a quickie. Okay. Question is, 2017 is the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. What does Pope Francis present us with in way of a prophetic opportunity to do something for non-Catholic Christians? One thought, Jim. 30 seconds.
Well, the core of the message for him is the Christian gospel, that the gospel that we all share. It's not the catechism of the Catholic Church. So I think that that's the common ground that he's lifting up.
Well, there are some problems in Lutheran theology, such as Luther's interpretation of Paul has been problematic in many ways, and we know that the introspective conscience, the idea of sin, once you have law, you automatically have sin, and so forth. And perhaps the Catholic Church can guide the Lutherans away from some of those problematic teachings.
I'm going to give your number away to my Lutheran friends. Kristin?
Mutual dialogue. Toward actual mutual dialogue. I was struck that Amoris Laetitia cites Bonhoeffer and Martin Luther King at not just local bishops' conferences and Babette's feast. So I think that's an important step, saying these are our riches of our shared tradition.
I think Luther's central message is the Catholic central message, which is that we are saved by God's wonderful grace and mercy toward us, and emphasizing that that's the ground of our salvation, and works flow from that, and we're not saving ourselves by our own works, is something that wouldn't be a bad thing for the American church, as well as the universal church.
Tom?
Before the conclave, there were a lot of people who said, you know, it's got to be a Latin American pope, the next one. The problem was when they drew up a list of the cardinals, they went through the list and they said, no, not him, not him, not him. And one of the reasons a lot of them got scratched is because they hate Protestants, most of them. The Latin American church is very non-ecumenical, especially the hierarchy, because they see the evangelicals stealing their sheep. Now, Bergoglio was an exception to this. He participated in evangelical, stadium prayer things, you know, with preaching. There was one where he went, and each preacher got up and preached, and it was his turn. And the dozen Protestant ministers came to him and said, you know, we have this custom that before you get up, before someone preaches, we pray over you. Is that okay? Can we do that with you? And he says, sure, and he drops to his knees, and suddenly you have 12 evangelical pastors imposing hands on the Archbishop of Buenos Aires, and a conservative paper took a picture and said, and the headline was, Archbishop in Apostasy, you know. So I think that's one side of it. The other side is that when you go out into the villages where the priest only shows up once a month, everybody goes to whatever service there is. If it's evangelical, okay. If there's an evangelical church, okay, we'll go there. When the priest comes, okay, we'll go to that. We'll go to Mass and have the sacraments, get baptized, you know, and wave goodbye when he leaves and go back over to the, you know, these differences don't make that much difference to them. So how's it gonna work out? I don't know how he's gonna put all that together, but I think he may be able to see that the Catholic Church is bigger than we ever thought it was. It includes all of Christianity.
I think he'll do what he does, which is try to build bridges. I do think one of the dynamics, following up on what Father Tom said, is I think he sees the liveliness of the evangelical church, and he is drawn to that in a way he may not be to the more magisterial, ecclesiological Protestant communions. I mean, I think that, But I think his dominant interfaith ecumenical concern is the Orthodox. I think one of the overlooked things about the whole synods on the family and the discussion of divorce and remarried was how much this is driven by his interest in unity with the Orthodox.
Please join me in thanking these extraordinary people.